Okay. So you should have this on your notes as well. When you create a box and whisker plot, it's going to separate your data into quadrants, quartiles, into 25% sections. So this is why you go looking at your first quartile, your second quartile, your third quartile. And there is variability within those quartiles. So those are the things we're going to see in your box and whisker. Because if they were all the same, if your data was all even, your box and whisker off of a number line would all be even as well. All of these parts would be even. But that doesn't always happen because all the sections, all the quartiles are not the same variability. So we're going to take a look at these. We need your five summary numbers because those are your maxes, your mins, your quartile one, quartile two, which is your median, and your quartile three. That's going to give us these points. So from those points, we're going to be able to make a box and whisker graph. That's how simple this is. Your horizontal axis, this is your horizontal axis. This is the only one we really have, is the range of your data, is a number line. This guy is a number line. It doesn't go by the parts that you found. It goes from the beginning, the min, to the max, number line. We're going to plot the five numbers above like this, and we're going to draw a box between the middle, and then we're going to draw the whiskers. Okay? Very, very basic. But that gives us a little information about what happened in the first quartile, what happened in the second quartile. Each one of these sections is 25% of your data. Your middle 25% add up to 50. That's half of your data right there. Okay, so from that we can make some kind of a little judgment. Your calculator does a box and whisker, but the problem with your calculator is you got to change all the windows on it. So you might as well just draw your number line and not use your calculator. It's probably easier. So in example one, if we walk back to example one, they gave us the minimum, the maximums from example one. We had a minimum of, remember this one had a very noticeable outlier, a minimum of 6, a maximum of 104, a quartile 1 of 9, a quartile 2, this is your median. Okay, we're going to make a box and whisker graph. Now, what happens on this is, I got a 104. My number line has to go from my beginning, which is essentially 0, I'm at 6, to 104. So whatever you can make your number line go by.
I'm sorry, I'll be back to my suite.
All right, I'm going to go from 0. And I'm just going to have to space this out because we've got a long range of data. And like, see if you can go by tens. And then this little guy over here is my 110. Okay. Now, to make a box and whisker, you need a complete number line. Just use your min and your max to create your number line. Don't put those values as spaces, because that's where we're going to have to put your box and whisker graph. So all I want you to do is this. At the 6, estimate where a 6 is, come above the line, and put a dot. At the max, 104, estimate where that is, come above, and put a dot. At the quartile 1, which is a 9, look how close it is to the 6. There's my 9. At the quartile 2, it's a 16. Well, that's pretty close in the middle here. And my last one is a 33. Now, the middle 3 is the box. The last 2 are the whiskers. So here's your box. Here's your whiskers. Can you see your outlier? See it even more noticeable? Every part of this is still 25% of your data. This little section right in here is still 25% of your data. This little section right in here, 25% of your data. So if you look back, to example one, where they list the data, it's on page 102. If you look back, look at how many fall small. You have a 6, you have a 7, you have an 8, you have a 9. See how many of that data sits right there? There were 15 pieces of data. So each one has like 4. So they're 6, 7, 8, 9 right in a row. That's why they're so close. These guys, a little bit more spread out. This one, very spread out. I can really see my outlier from here. Right? If we did our interquartile range like we did yesterday, remember how we did this for your interquartile range? We took your interquartile range and we said to find if there's an outlier. Your IQR, this one minus this one, so we have 33 minus 9, this gave us 24. And then we multiply this by 1.5. So if we multiply this by 1.5, we get 36. We took 36 off our quartile 1, which put us way down here, so there were no datas out of our range. We took 36 and we added it to this guy, and 36 would only come to about here. So this guy, a serious, serious outlier. And we could tell that obviously from this diagram. But if we use your formula, he's a serious outlier. He's going to change my data around. So box and whisker graphs are very, very nice ways to represent your data. Okay, let's do another one together. Your try it too, I'll give you the pieces that you have here. You had a min of 17, you had a max of 45. This one will be a little nicer to see. Quartile 1, 23.5, median, and quartile 3, 41. Okay, so we're going to take this and make a number line. Write this down. You have to have one in your notebooks. This is a great one to have. It needs a title. Try it too. Let me see what try it too is. Try it too. Where's the tuition class? So we're going to call this tuition class. I need a number line. Where should my number line go? From where to where? Okay, 10 to 50. So I've got a big space of things. Can I go by fives?
Yes.
Yeah. So I can go by five. 15, 20. Oops. Sorry. Now, when you put your box and whisker, don't put it on that line. Put it above it. So plot your first point, your minimum, 17. Find 17, put a dot. Find your max, 45. Your quartile 1, 23.5, kind of close to 24. Your median, not your quartile 2, 30. And your quartile 3, 41. This is what you should have right now. So your box has whiskers on it. So the whiskers are the two ends. These are my whiskers, the ends. That means my box is my middle three. This represents 50% of my data, 25 and 25. So here's my whiskers. These separate these into quartiles. So what can you tell me about quartile one and versus quartile? This is 1, 2, 3, and 4. Because this is quartile, where quartile 1 is, that means this part is quartile 1. This is my quartile 2, that means this part is quartile 2. Up to there, we finished quartile 2. We finished 50% of our data. Make sense? Because some kids get confused and say, this is quartile 1, then you forgot about this one. So up to here, you did one quarter of your data. A quarter is worth 25%. 25 cents, 25%. So up to here, you did two quarters of your data. Isn't that 50% of your data? Right? up to here, and then up to here. These are both, so quartile 3 falls in here. Quartile 4 falls right here, in here. Which one had the most spread? Which quartile? 3. 3 is the widest one we have, right? And that's why our number line has to be a number line. You can't put these values on your number line, because then it will look even. Quartile 4, kind of small. Which one do you think is the smallest? 4. So 4 and 1 look kind of even to me. So how can I be sure which one is the smallest? How can I mathematically be sure? Yeah, good job. Here's my min at 17. Here's my quartile 1 at 23.5. If I subtract them, I get 6.5. Here's my guy at 45. Here's my one at 41. If I subtract 45 minus 41, I have 4. So yeah, that is my smallest. So don't forget, you're putting this on a number line. You're approximating where these things fall based on your number line. My number line goes by 5. So I'm kind of approximating where it falls. But if I needed to look at which one was the had the most variability, the least variability, I'd want to see who has the smallest difference, who has the largest difference. So 1/4 of my data falls here, 1/4 here, 1/4 here, 1/4 here. Reasonable? Okay. All right. Percentiles are, again, you divided it into length sections. Percentiles, guys, don't get confused with percentiles being what your score is versus what percentile you fall in. Like when you take standardized tests, sometimes like in elementary school and whatnot, you get those little bars that say you're 62%, you're 88%. It didn't mean that was your score. So if you remember getting those little bar things, then they had those things that went like this. Oh, this is like math calculations. This is my reading vocabulary. It didn't mean you scored this. It means this was where you ranked, your percentile. Like your percentile in the class rank is a percentile, not your scores, your rank. So I did better than, if this is 82%, means I did better than 82% of the kids that took this test. It doesn't mean I scored an 82 on this test. So a percentile, just be careful with percentiles. What section you fall in a percentile? Guys, because that's important. Okay, it's not a score. All right, so here's an ogive. It's in your book. You probably have a better chance looking in your book. Page 106. What number, what score on the SATs falls in at the 67th percentile, 62nd percentile? What score would you say? What would you say? 1600, that's a good estimate. That's a very good estimate. We're estimating. We're coming across here. Here's my percentile. It probably looks better in your book. It's a little dark up here. And come down here. It looks like it falls right to the right of the 1500, and if I count 15, 16, 17, 18, that is my 1600 score. So if you scored 1600, you're in the 62 percentile. When the college looks at your SAT scores, they don't look at the score per se, they look at the percentile. What score puts you in the 90 percentile and above? What score puts you in the 50 percentile and above? Okay. So they look at your percentile, and when we figure out these scores, you'll see how we find those, because they actually make sense by the time we do those. What I don't like about this unit is we hit on little things, and then once you see your z-scores work, they kind of make a little bit more sense, because we use your tables. So if I had a percentile of 80%, what score do you think corresponds to 80%? 80%. Nine, 18, 19, somewhere between there, right? Because we would follow this down.
come down. Here's an 80 percentile. Come straight down. So maybe 1800. It's hard in your book because it looks very small. So probably like an 1800 score. And that's a pretty high score, isn't it? On your SATs? Mm-hmm. That puts you way up there in your rank. Is it based on 24?
No, right now it's 16.
Oh, right now it's back to 16?
Mm-hmm.
16. Oh, okay. No essay? 16?
Well,
or with essay?
Without the essay, it's a
separate
score.
Oh, there's
seven. The
essay
is at
24
points.
Oh, okay. Okay. 16, that's what it was when I was young. When I was young. Okay, though. We still did SATs when I went to school. It was based on 1600. Math, 800. English, 800. We had no essays. And then every time they changed it, they made it 2400 for a while. And they brought it back down again. Okay. So everybody's pretty much got that? All right. Here's an important part, a very, very important part. Finding a percentile. You with me? This is important. To find the percentile that corresponds to a specific x value. It's going to be on your test as well. So, we take the number of entries less than that number out of the total number of data. It's just a ratio. And then we multiply it by 100. So if we want to find the percentile, here's a good one. An example two, these were in thousands. So if we want one that corresponds to 30, they have to be in order if you're going to count this. And your calculator can absolutely sort them. If they give them to you not in order, your calculator can sort them. And you could even, if you look at your table, if you put this in your table, say this wasn't in order, or even if it is, if you put this in your table, you know how it gives you the number where you're entering your data? If you go back to that entry, you can actually find what was my 10th entry, what was my 12th entry. Do it in your table, it makes it a little bit easier. So if I want to correspond to a 30, in other words, I'd put this in my L1, I'd come to 30, and 30 would say, 30 would say number 10. This would be my 10th entry. Do you know what I'm saying in your table when you enter these? You know when you put it in your L1? And at the bottom it says what number you're entering. So when you come to 30, it's going to say my 10th entry. 10th entry was 30. That means there are 9 entries less than this. Sometimes your calculator makes it a little bit easier. You don't have to count or put it in order. So now I find out how many are less than that one. So I have 9. Out of how many entries? Out of 25. This gives me a ratio, part over whole. How many are less than me? So this is the same as 36%. Just multiply it by 100. It'll give you a fraction, and then you just reduce it and multiply it by 100. So you are ranked at the 36th percentile. Your calculator makes it, I like the calculator, because I don't have to count anything. Where it gets a little tricky is when it falls like at the 32, and you have two 32s, go to the first one. If it's a 32 and there's two 32s, go to the first one. So if I want to know what my rank is, if I had 32,000, I would pick the first one. Because this is the same as me. These guys are all less than me. So in my calculator, this would say my 12th entry. Then therefore, I would have 11 over 25. And I would multiply that by 100. And I'd get 44th percentile. I'm at the 44th percentile. Okay? So see what this is doing? Just giving you a ratio of who's less than you. So that figures out where your rank is. If you're figuring to the 26th percentile, so find me the one for the 26th percentile. Find me the rank for the 26th. your question says for the 26,000. What percentile am I at if I had 26,000? And how'd you get that?
Because there are four below me. So four divided by 25. 25 goes into 100 four times. So just multiply that by four. 16%. She's at the 16th percentile. Good. That's all you need to do to figure out your percentile, your ranking. And that's how they figure out your ranking for your class. Where are you ranked? They figure out how many people in your class, how many people are you above, how many people are below you, based on the total. There's your ranking. Okay. And I think now this brings us to z-scores. Why they put z-scores at the end of this is a question, but we're still going to hit this. I'm not sure if you did this at all in Algebra 2. Does this look familiar? Those of you that remember Algebra 2? Do you remember doing the formula to find the z-score? Algebra 2. So, when did you take Algebra 2? Last year or 10th year? All right, what I need you guys to do is just give me 1 second to see if I have any kids for us. Okay, here's the problem. This is on your note page, so make sure you pull your note page out. Okay, the z-score represents the number of standard deviations for any given x value that falls from the mean. If it falls to the left of the mean, your z-score will be negative. Make sense? Smaller than the mean, less than the mean. If it falls to the right of the mean, your z-score will be positive. If it falls on the mean, that means it didn't vary off the mean, the z-score is zero. There's no variance off the mean. Now, how does this work? Watch. Say I have a mean of, let's make life simple, 80. And I have a standard deviation of 5. Okay? Now, here's my 80, here's my 85, my 90, my 95. Here's my 75, my 70, my 65. So I want to know what is the standard deviation, two standard deviations above the mean. What score is that? 90. What is one standard deviation below the mean?
75.
What is the z-score? We call these z-scores now. We're gonna rename these to z-scores. What is the z-score of a score of 95?
3.
Brandon, 3. Good. What is the z-score of a 65?
-3.
What is the z-score of a 62?
That would be -3.4.
Okay,
so somewhere it's past the negative 3, right?
Yeah.
And it does exist.
It says 62.
62.
No, wait,
I said 62?
No, wait, it's negative 3.66.
Okay, so we need to find out exactly because we can't find that from our table. So we use a z-score formula. So watch. When we did a score of 90, you told me the z-score was 2. So if my x value is 90, I use this nice little formula. 90 minus my mean divided by my standard deviation. That gave me 10 divided by 5. That gave me 2. So isn't it a standard deviation of 2 above the mean?
Yeah.
Yes. And I set a standard a z-score of 75. I say 75 minus my mean divided by my standard deviation. Isn't 75 minus 80 come out to be a negative number?
Negative 5.
Negative 5. A negative 5 divided by 5 is negative 1. And didn't we say that was negative 1? So now let's find a score of 62. So I take 62 minus 80. Should that come out to be positive or negative?
Negative.
Negative. And didn't we expect it to be in the negatives? So I divide. I do 62 minus 80. So just do 62 minus 80 and divide it by 5. So negative 3.6. But that wasn't easy. You guys did a great job with that. It wasn't easy to find on this. How about a score of 91? I can say, well, I expect it to be a little over 2, right? So now let's use our formula. 91 minus 80, it's going to be positive according to this. So I have 11 over 5, 2.2. Good. I want you to be able to get good estimates out of this.
You should run a casino.
Because what are you saying, Jake? Every point
shows up
is
by point two.
Point two. Why?
And the negatives, of course, two. Because each if it's going to be one whole number from 90 to 95, it's 5 notches.
Five notches. Good. Now, this doesn't happen on every single one, but Jake found a pattern here. Between five of these, what is this thing even?
Good story.
All right. So Jake found a pattern. By five every two, it has to make 10. So he found a pattern. It doesn't work with every single one. But this is the formula that we will use to find our z-scores. So you've been doing them when they fall at the plus or minus 2, plus or minus 1. These are how we'll find our z-scores. Now, remember how I had you find percentages to see what the area under your curve is? They go by tables in the back of your book. They don't exactly use the tables yet, but, all right, so I won't use the tables yet. I will use the tables. That's just because I like the tables. If you look in the back of your book, and I'll have the tables for you tomorrow. I thought I had copies of them. If you go to page A16, it's in the appendix in the back of the book. A16. It's in the appendix at the back of the book. Turn to A16. Yeah, I don't know really what those CDs are good for. They don't really, they're not the book. It's like different data from the problems are all on that CD.
Which is
but
A16?
A16.
Oh, A.
No, A. It's in the appendix at the back of the book. It's right before the one with the blue margin. There's a 2-page table 4, it's called. I'm just going to talk about it briefly, but then we'll spend more time with it at another point in time. But I do like you to make a connection, because when we do probability, I need you to know this part. Table 4, it's 2 parts. A negative side and a positive side. See the difference? Gives you all the negative pieces, gives you all the positive pieces. Now, look at the top of A16, where it says negative 3.4, and it says 0.09. That means this represents negative 3.49. This is just the hundredths place. It gave you a whole number, a tenth, and this is a hundredths place. Therefore, we're going to round our z-scores to two decimals, because that's what your table gives you. Now, see this number right here? That's the smallest number on your table. That means, because every time we look at 3.4, negative 3.4, it's way over here somewhere, there's a very, very tiny, tiny little space to the left of it. This is always area to the left. Okay? Now, so that area is very small. Now just kind of look through that side of the table. I wish I had a copy, but I don't. Look through that side of the table. Go all the way through. Do you see your area is increasing? What's the highest one that it gets to? What's the highest area that it gets to? Look at those numbers in that chart. What is it? Negative. No, go through that whole chart. Look inside here, this part of it. What's the highest number that it gets to? Hi. No, I want, this is real small, isn't it? My area here keeps decreasing.
0.5.
Ah, 0.5 right down here, isn't it? And what is that z-score for 0.5?
Negative
0. 0. And what does this say? 0. So at the 0, 0, doesn't this make sense to me? This is half of my curve.
What's the smallest number?
I wanted the biggest number in this part of it. 0.500, that's half, right? 0.5 is half.
But isn't it negative because it's next to the negative
0.0? Well, 0.00 is virtually, even though that's a negative side, it's going to continue on the positive side at 0.5. 0 is still neither negative nor positive, but they have to have like an end to their chart, so that's where it ends. Notice that's where it picks up on the next side. Look at the next side where it's positive 0. Isn't the positive 0 also 0.5? Do you see those areas growing, getting larger? Because now every time I go to the left, isn't that a bigger area? We're always measuring area to the left. So when we start getting into z-scores, this sketch is so important. Because when we find a z-score up here, and we want to know what percentile is this, I can go right to this chart. So when we took a 91 and we found our z-score to be 2.2, just follow with me for a minute. Here's 2. Go to the right side of the chart. Come across the 2.0, the 2.2, sorry, and go to the 0.0 up here and tell me what that number is. Find 2.2 with the 0 up on top. Tell me what that 4-digit number is. No, go to 2.2. No, go to positive 2.2 on the right-hand side. Put 9861. That means when I find the score of 91, that means you were better than 98.61% of the whole.
Where do we just find
it? On the right-hand side of that page, the right side, is the positives. So look up 2.20. That's our z-score we found. So now, isn't this my percentile? Aren't I better than 98.6% of the field? We're going to spend a lot more time with this chart, but I want you to see where z-scores actually are used. There's your percentile. So when a college looks, unless you do like the thing you figure out every entry that's there, but we don't know how to. Number of entries here
right
now.
We will
always have that chart, and we can do that with calculator as well. On the calculator, it's much easier. But I just kind of want to give you a perspective of what these z-scores do, because z-scores is where, like, I'm about to change the world with the z-scores. You thought you could just only find a few of them, but you can find a lot of them. So tomorrow we'll finish this off, guys.